The Resurrection Key by Andy McDermott. Read by Jonathan Keeble. Prologue. The Southern Ocean. A frigid wind bit Arnold Becker's cheeks as he gazed at the ragged white peaks rising from the grey waters ahead. After 6 days at sea, the prospect of standing on solid ground was a blessed relief. But the terrain ahead was not land. The stark vista was an iceberg, a 2-mile-long slab that had carved away from Antarctica. The research vessel Dionysus was on a mission that to most people sounded crazy. Even those behind it, Becker included, occasionally questioned their own sanity. Their objective was to chart the berg officially known as D-43 and test the feasibility of towing the entire colossal mass the 3,000 miles to Cape Town in South Africa. If it could be done, it would provide the parched country with billions of gallons of pure, fresh water. Crazy indeed. But if the plan paid off, it would not only save a nation from thirst, but make its backers a fortune. No risk, no reward, as Becker's fiancé liked to say. He agreed with the sentiment, but at the same time it drew a wry smile. He was the one freezing his balls off, while Yemke oversaw the operation from a climate-controlled office back home. He retreated into the relative warmth of the ship's bridge. A plotting table was laid out with a large blow-up of D-43's most recent satellite photograph, 2 weeks old. The first task was to circumnavigate the iceberg to check for any more recent changes, a section breaking away, for instance, or a fault line developing.
"Are we ready to start?" Becker asked.
The Dionysus' skipper, Botild Hovman, tapped at the picture's edge.
"We are here. We'll go around it clockwise, a kilometre out. Won't that be too far to see anything?" "We'll see enough, and we'll be clear of the most bergy bits and growlers."
Becker hid his amusement at hearing the terms for smaller ice fragments pronounced in a strong Swedish accent, and went to the windows. The iceberg filled his view, its various strata standing out clearly. The deepest submerged parts were at least 1 million years old, prehistoric snow compacted into ultra-dense blue ice. D-43's visible bulk was only about 1/10 that age, but still ancient. If the plan worked, the residents of Cape Town could be drinking water from ice older than the whole of human civilization. Hovman issued orders, then brought the Dionysus on a course paralleling the iceberg's western flank. Becker watched the great mass slide past. This close, second thoughts rose about the whole project. Would even a couple of repurposed supertankers, the only vessels theoretically powerful enough to tow such a colossal object, be enough? He considered calling Yemke over the satellite video link to voice his doubts, but held off. They had already spoken an hour ago, when the iceberg was first sighted, and the bandwidth was not cheap. Better to wait until he had something specific to report. The ship continued around the berg. In places, surface snow had been washed away to leave a surreal landscape of glassy ice. D-43 had partially rolled as it tore free of the ice cap, exposing strata of cyan and turquoise and deep blue. No photograph could have prepared him for the sheer beauty of the sight. Maybe Yemke would regret staying in the warmth after all. His entrancement was disturbed by a discussion between Hovman and a crewman.
"What is it?"
asked the South African.
"Something odd on the radar," the captain replied. "Inside the ice."
Becker came to see. On the screen, the iceberg showed up as a ragged, fuzzy line to the right of the central dot marking the Dionysus's position. The ice's varying density accounted for the radar return's diffuse appearance, but within it was a sharply defined shape.
"What's that?"
"Don't know," said Hoffman. "It's solid, though. Rock or metal."
"How could it be metal?"
"Meteor, perhaps. Or a ship or plane. That deep in the ice."
Becker looked back at the swathes of blue, the product of time, far older than the couple of centuries since humans started to build their ships from metal rather than wood. But the shape on the radar screen seemed too symmetrical to be a mere rock.
even one that had fallen from space. So what could it be? He let out a brief, involuntary laugh.
What?
Asked Havman.
I just wondered if it was a UFO.
A spaceship, he clarified.
But that's ridiculous, isn't it?
Havman's studiously blank expression spoke volumes. He regarded the radar screen again.
We might be able to see it soon. There's an opening in the ice.
He pointed out an indentation in the fuzzy line. Becker went to the windows and saw it for real.
It's a cave.
Halfman followed his gaze with binoculars.
A big one. We could probably fit the whole ship inside.
Chuckles from the bridge crew.
I don't think that would be wise, said the captain. We could send in the boat, though, if that's what you want to do. It'll cost us time.
Becker took his point, but the cave was tantalizingly close.
We need to see what it is, he decided. We are doing a survey, after all. How long would it take?
30 minutes, perhaps. Havman checked the water.
Not too much floating ice. We can bring the ship closer.
Becker tried not to sound too childishly enthusiastic.
Okay, let's do it. If it's nothing, we'll carry on with the survey.
As you wish. The Swede adjusted the Dionysus's course. The ship soon drew level with the opening. Becker tried to see inside, but all he could make out were twilight blue walls of ice. He went back to the radar. The object should have been in line with the entrance.
I can't see it.
Havman rechecked the screen.
It must be embedded higher up. We'll definitely have to take the boat in. Maybe we can climb up to it.
The captain cocked an eyebrow.
We? Mr. Becker, do you have any experience in ice climbing?
No, but you're my client. But you're also my passenger, so your safety is my responsibility. You hired people who know what they're doing. Let them go.
I suppose you're right,
Becker reluctantly agreed. The Dionysus heaved to, crewmen preparing its boat for launch, while Havman and Becker spoke to the man and woman who would make the trip. Wim Stapper was a blond Dutchman with the wiry build of an extreme sports enthusiast, while the Finnish, Sanna Onvan, had short, fiery red hair and the strong upper body of someone who spent much time dangling from high places. Both were in their late 20s and expert ice climbers. They were as enthusiastic as Becker about the unexpected side mission.
If it is a UFO, said Onvan, grinning, maybe we get to take selfies with space aliens.
We don't know if it's a UFO, said Becker. If it's just a big rock, then we'll carry on with the survey. But,
a smile,
if it is a spaceship, get lots of pictures.
Havman shook his head.
You have all seen too many movies. Don't get too excited. That is when you make mistakes.
We will be okay,
Stapper assured him as he zipped up his red coat.
We know what we're doing.
Good. Then don't take any risks. Then stay safe.
Risk is our business. And our hobby,
said Onvan cheerily. The captain was unimpressed, but kept any further comments to himself. Instead, he led the way to the ship's tender, a bright orange 30-foot rigid inflatable boat. Onvan and Stapper boarded. Then the rib was lowered into the water, and the pair set out, Onvan at the tiller. Becker looked towards the cave. The waters were dotted with growlers, relatively small hunks of ice that nevertheless could weigh as much as a car. As with all icebergs, most of their mass was hidden beneath the surface, seemingly innocuous pieces becoming potentially shipwrecking obstacles.
Watch out for the ice, okay?
He said into the walkie-talkie. The retreating Stapper made a show of scanning the sea.
Ice! Ice! Oh! That ice, he said, gasping at the berg. Funny. Okay, see what's in there.
Becker watched the boat weave around the bobbing growlers towards the cave mouth. Then he and Halfman returned to the bridge.
What's it like?
The South African asked as the rib slipped into the shadows. The reply was surprisingly distorted, considering the short range. A crackle behind Stapper's words.
Everything is blue. Very beautiful. Can you see the thing in the ice? A bad choice of words, if you've seen the movies I have,
The Dutchman laughed.
We're coming out of the entrance tunnel.
A long silence.
Wim, are you still there?
Asked Becker, concerned. The reply was prefaced by another laugh, but one of nervous disbelief rather than humour.
Yes, we are. And so is, you know, we were joking about a UFO.
Yes?
I think that is what we have found.
The silence this time was on Becker's part.
Are you joking?
He finally managed.
No, I'm not. It's inside the ice, stuck in the cave wall. It is metal and big. As big as a plane, I'm not kidding you.
Stapper added preemptively.
It really does look like a UFO,
Unvan added in the background.
It's hard to tell exactly, but I'd say about a third of it is out of the ice,
Stapper went on.
It's at an angle. There are windows near the front. They look like eyes.
Becker practically heard the shiver in the other man's voice as he realized what he had just said.
Can you get to it?
Yeah. The cliff climb looks easy. Oh!
Both Halfman and Becker flinched.
What is it?
Demanded the captain.
I see a way in. There's a hatch in the side.
We can reach it, no problem,
said Onvan.
I don't know,
Becker said, misgivings growing. Assuming this wasn't some dumb joke by the climbers, and he didn't think their acting ability was up to it, then they had found something unknown. And the unknown could be dangerous.
Take pictures and then come back. We need to see what we're dealing with. No, it'll take 2 minutes to climb to the door,
replied Stapper.
We can't come this far and not look inside.
Frustrated, Becker looked to Halfman for support.
If they were my crew, I would order them back, said the captain.
You are their boss.
Yeah.
He spoke into the radio again.
No, get back here. Or...
He halted, aware there wasn't anything he could threaten them with, short of being fired, and then the expedition would be over before it even began.
Just get back to the ship.
The lack of a response meant the pair were either ignoring him or already climbing the ice wall.
Pilkop,
he muttered. The walkie-talkie remained silent for a few fraught minutes, then crackled to life.
We are at the door,
said Stapper at last. The distortion was worse than before.
It's big, nearly 3 meters high. It opened when Santa touched a round thing on it. We're going in.
Becker sighed in resignation. They were entering with or without his permission.
If there's any danger, get out and come back to the ship. We will. But the ice is solid. I don't think...
The Dutchman was abruptly cut off by a harsh core of static.
Wim,
said Becker.
Wim, can you hear me? Wim!
No answer.
Shit.
Halfman marched to the helm.
I will bring the ship closer. If they are in trouble, we can reach them faster.
Good, okay,
Becker replied, before trying the radio again. There was still no response.
Why did you let them go in?
Demanded Iemka Joubert over the satellite link. The video quality was low and glitchy, the computers at each end straining to make the most of the parsimonious bandwidth.
I told them not to,
said Becker. 30 minutes had passed since his last contact with the explorers. He had called his fiancée, as much to vent about the situation as report on it.
This is what happens when you hire thrill seekers. They go seeking thrills.
When I hired them?
Okay, when we hired them. But we lost contact when they went inside this thing and still haven't heard anything from them.
What is this thing?
Yemka asked.
What did you find?
I don't want to say on an open channel. Let's call it an old ship.
What, like a sailing ship?
I'll tell you more when I can set up an encrypted link.
A disbelieving laugh.
You really think anyone is eavesdropping?
I don't want to take any chances. Trust me, Yemka.
I do. Otherwise, I wouldn't have let you go down to the bottom of the world, would I?
He chuckled.
You want to swap places? You're the one who knows all about ships.
I'm fine here, thanks. Did I mention it's 22 Celsius today?
No.
And I wish you hadn't. But the Dionysus isn't equipped for salvage work, so we'd have to...
He stopped at a sudden rasp from the radio. Halfman snatched it up.
Hello, hello, he said. Are you all right?
An ear-shredding screech of static, then a voice pierced the distortion.
It's after Hadot. It's after Hadot. Oh my God, help me.
It's Wim,
said Becker, jumping up in alarm. His native Afrikaans was very similar to Dutch, and he knew exactly what Stapper was saying. It killed her. It killed her. My God, help me.
Wim, what happened? What killed her? What happened to Sana?
The crew reacted in shock.
Help me! Help!
Came the panicked reply.
Oh, God! He's coming after me!
What is?
The demon! Sana, walk it up!
Stapper's words were cut off, not by static, but a loud thump, followed by banging sounds. He had slipped, skidding down an icy slope. Then came a pained shout as he hit something. But it was not the only shout. In the background was another voice, with a strange, throaty echo to it that barely sounded human. Then the channel fell silent.
Wim!
Yelled Becker.
Wim! Can you hear me? Wim!
He turned to Halfman.
We've got to help him. We need to get into the cave. If you launch the lifeboat...
Are you mad?
Said the Swede.
There's a murderer running around.
He hesitated. Then, with clear trepidation, issued orders to the crew.
We'll take the whole ship inside,
he told Becker.
We'll be protected while we look for him.
The Dionysus's engines came to life. Becker stared fearfully at the shadowy cave mouth, then belatedly realized that someone was calling his name.
Arnold! Arnold! What's going on?
Said Iemka over the satellite link.
Iemka, something's happened,
he replied.
Wim and Sana are in trouble.
What kind of trouble?
But I'm sorry, I have to go. I'll call you back as soon as we found them. I love you.
I love you too, but...
He ended the call and rushed to the windows. The ship quickly closed on the iceberg. Dull thunks echoed through the hull as the prows struck bobbing growlers. The entrance loomed ahead.
Will we fit?
We'll fit,
said Halfman grimly.
Try to get him on the radio.
Becker called Stapper to no avail. The captain slowed, bringing the Dionysus into line with the cave's tall but relatively narrow mouth. The South African watched, then suddenly remembered something.
He said eat.
Halfman didn't divert his gaze from the icy passage.
What? Wim said it killed Sana, not he. He was panicking. People say the wrong words when they panic. But he said it several times. It killed her. It was coming after him. And there was something else. He called it the demon. The demon.
The temperature on the bridge seemed to drop as its occupants exchanged worried looks. Halfman was the first to speak, standing straight and resolute.
It doesn't matter. All that does matter is that we rescue him.
He eased the Dionysus into the gap. Becker tensed, but Halfman guided the ship cleanly through the cave mouth. The change in lighting from the stark whites and blues outside to sapphire-tinted gloom rendered him momentarily blind. He blinked, trying to take in his new surroundings, as the 400-ton survey vessel slipped into the mysterious cave. Shadows swallowed it.
There! I see something! 5 degrees to port!
Ulus Cancel, captain of the freighter Fortune Mist, stared intently through his binoculars. The ship had been halfway through its voyage between New Zealand and Cape Town with a cargo of frozen lamb when it received a weak distress call. A 9-hour diversion at full speed had brought it to the source, but now the signal from the RV Dionysus had fallen silent. Cancel had been a mariner for almost 30 years. He knew all too well that that was a bad sign. The Dionysus had almost certainly sunk. But that didn't mean there weren't survivors. A spot of colour against the grey sea had caught his eye, a man in a red coat huddled on a chunk of floating ice.
Man overboard! Mr. Figueroa! Mr. Kramer, launch a lifeboat!
The crewman hurried from the bridge. The Cypriot surveyed the surrounding waters. There was a large iceberg a few kilometers distant. The glossy sheen of raw, snow-free ice over much of its surface told him it had recently rolled. Had the Dionysus been crushed by it? He wouldn't know until they completed a wider search, but the priority was recovering the survivor. An order, and the Fortune Mist's horn sounded. At first, the figure didn't move, leading counsel to fear he was dead. But then he shifted slightly.
He's still alive!
The captain called out.
Head him aboard, quick!
The lifeboat reached the floating ice. Jakob Kramer regarded the stranded man warily. The floe was only small, and the lean German was sure it would pitch over if he climbed onto it.
Hey! Can you hear me?
He shouted in English. No response. He asked the same in his native language, but the man remained still.
Hold us steady,
he told Figueroa.
I'll pull him closer.
He maneuvered a boat hook to snag the man's coat. Straining, he pulled him across the ice until he was almost within reach. The floe rocked, bumping the lifeboat. Kramer cursed, then stretched out as far as he dared. His gloved fingers caught fabric. He clutched it tightly and hauled the unconscious man to the boat's side. The ice tipped again, sending a freezing splash over the man's legs. He flinched, but his rescuer now had a firm hold. Figueroa joined in, then they brought the limp figure aboard. Kramer examined him. The man was young, his face pale from the cold. If he had spent much longer exposed to the elements, he would be dead.
Get us back to the ship fast,
the German said. Figueroa returned to the outboard and brought the boat around.
We got you,
Kramer said, trying to reassure the survivor.
You are safe.
The man's eyes snapped open. The sailor felt a sudden unease. He was looking through rather than at him, the gaze almost manic in its terrified intensity.
Demon.
Kramer blinked at the feeble whisper.
What?
Demon,
the man in red repeated. His accent sounded Dutch.
In the ice, Sana woke it. It killed her. We took the key.
Kramer realized his passenger was clutching something tightly to his chest. He looked more closely and saw a glint of metal. Gold.
We woke the demon,
the young man went on. His breathing quickened.
It killed Sana. Killed everyone.
Kramer was more interested in what he held than his words. Demons? His near death had obviously driven him mad. He shifted to block Figueroa's line of sight with his body, then started to prise the man's fingers open.
No! No!
Gasped the Dutchman.
The key! Don't give it the key!
We will be at the ship soon,
said Kramer loudly, trying to drown out his voice. He finally forced the young man's hands apart and tugged the object free.
It's okay!
No!
He cried again.
They killed...
He slumped in exhaustion.
It's okay,
Kramer said again, giving Figueroa a surreptitious glance before examining his prize. What it was, he had no idea. It certainly didn't look like a key. A plate-sized metal disc, its central hub inlaid with a circle of polished purple stone, into which was set a large crystal. At first, he had thought the object was gold, but now he saw it wasn't quite the right color, with a distinctly reddish tinge. Writing was inscribed in its surface, but he didn't recognize the language. He turned it over. Both the stone and the crystal continued all the way through its center. More unknown words ran around them. One symbol was unmistakable, though. A skull. It faced to the left, jaw open as if shouting. It was oddly deformed, the back of the head elongated. Something about it unsettled Kramer. Maybe the survivor's ravings about demons had got to him. He shook off the thought and hid the object inside his coat. Even if the gold wasn't pure, its weight told him it was still worth a lot of money, and the only other person who knew about it was a madman, in shock from his ordeal. He wouldn't be believed.
No. You didn't have anything when we found you. You must have lost it in the water. Sorry.
The German pulled his zipper back up. He felt no guilt about what he had just done. The man was still alive, wasn't he? that was worth more than any piece of treasure, and it gave Kramer the chance to escape from the drudgery of life aboard a freighter. He knew of places online where such salvage could be sold, with no awkward questions asked. A few months from now, his life could change forever. He smiled at the thought, then looked down in alarm as the man stirred.
"That's a ship," he said hastily. "You're safe."
"No, not safe," came the weak reply. "More demons. Sleeping in the ice."
His hand searched for the object with growing desperation.
"The key. Where is it?"
"I don't know,"
replied the German.
"You must have lost it in the water."
"No, I had it. Listen."
He suddenly clawed at Kramer's coat, pulling the startled crewman closer.
"The key. It wakes them. Sana woke one. It killed her. Killed everyone on the ship. If they wake, they'll kill us all."
His voice rose to a shout.
"The demons will kill us all!"
Chapter 1. New York City, 4 months later. Professor Nina Wilde paused for dramatic effect as she regarded her students, then spoke.
"My first rule of archaeology. No find is worth risking your or anyone else's life over."
That aroused surprise from her audience.
"Yeah, I know that may sound weird from someone with my track record," she went on. "But I'm speaking from experience. Very, very painful experience. I've lost count of how often I've almost been killed out in the field, and a couple of times in my own home. But I forced myself to keep a very good account of the people who actually were killed because of my discoveries. And it's too many. Which is why I'm talking to you in a lecture hall rather than chasing around the world after legends."
"But you've found so many," said a young woman.
This early in their first semester, Nina hadn't yet memorized all her students' names.
"Madison?"
"Yeah, I have. But I wanted to leave some for you to find as well."
Some laughter at the joke, which was a relief. It was only the redhead's second year in her academic role, and she still found balancing research and teaching hard.
"I hope I'll inspire you to make your own discoveries. But I also want you to learn from my mistakes."
"What mistakes?"
asked a man. A boy, God, they were all so young, she was fairly sure was called Aiden.
"I used to think it was my job, my duty, to bring lost wanderers back to the world,"
Nina told him.
"Which I did. Atlantis, the Tomb of Hercules, El Dorado, Valhalla, the Ark of the Covenant, and more besides." "It's a very impressive list."
She remembered this youth's name, Hui Cheng, a student from China. Her concern that he had won admission to the university based solely on his wealthy parents' bank balance had already been assuaged by his work, breadth of knowledge, and drive.
"Thank you, but it came at a price. It seems like every discovery I made had some madman or occasionally mad woman after it for nefarious ends. And I don't just mean tomb raiding for money. I faced people trying to start wars, take over countries, nuke cities."
"You didn't talk about this in your books,"
said Aiden dubiously.
"My books are about the actual archaeology. If you want explosions and gunfights and car chases, you can always watch the ridiculous movies based on them."
More laughter. She let it subside, then continued more somberly.
"But the antimatter explosion in the Persian Gulf 3 years ago? That was caused by something I found. And Big Ben in London collapsed. Again, caused by one of my discoveries. The religious cult gassed in the Caribbean. The skyscraper destroyed in Tokyo. All ultimately my responsibility."
"But you weren't personally responsible,"
said Cheng.
"The incident in Antigua, you've been kidnapped. You didn't have a choice."
"They wouldn't have happened if I hadn't been involved,"
Nina insisted.
"My thought process at the time was, I can find these things. So I must find these things. I never considered whether I should find these things."
"So you wish you hadn't found them?"
Madison asked.
"You think your whole career's been a mistake?"
"No, but I think I've made mistakes.
The lesson they've taught me is actually my second rule. Think before you dig. Before you put the tip of your trowel into the ground, ask yourself some very big questions. Am I the right person to make this discovery? Am I doing so for the right reasons? And most of all, do I have the ability to protect this discovery? If you can't truthfully answer yes to all three, then you should hold off. Always remember that your actions will make you a part of history too, and you want it to look favorably upon you. She cast her gaze across her students one by one. What I've come to realize is that you need great wisdom to know if you should return an ancient wonder to the world. Even after everything I've experienced, I'm still not sure I have that wisdom. A pause. Then, with dark humor, and I'm damn sure none of you do. She knew that would not go down well. Most of the young men and women limited their affronted responses to facial expressions, unwilling to challenge a professor. But there were inevitably a few vocal objections.
I don't think that's fair, said Aiden. You don't know us.
No, Nina replied. Not as individuals, but I'm 45, and by now I know people. You're all what? 18, 19, 20? That's an age where in many ways I envy you. The whole world's just opened up, and you can do anything. You can even bend down without your back hurting. Damn, I miss those days.
The humor helped ease the tension.
But, she continued, while you've got limitless energy and enthusiasm, you don't have experience. And I can tell you, ironically enough, from experience, that when you're young, if someone tries to give you the benefit of their experience, you're all like, yeah, whatever, Grandma. I was the same. And unfortunately, that got me into trouble. Trouble that affected other people. If I'd realized what I was getting into, I would have done things differently. Or possibly not at all.
But then everything you've discovered would have remained lost, said Cheng. Our knowledge of ancient history would be incomplete. It would be wrong.
It would be, yeah. But that goes back to my first rule. Is that knowledge worth the lives lost to uncover it? All of you, take a look at each other.
Nina waited for them to do so.
Now, if you thought you were on the verge of making an amazing discovery, but you knew that in doing so, you'd be directly responsible for the deaths of some of your classmates, would you still do it?
The question aroused discussion. Cheng was first to reply.
But that's a flawed premise, Professor.
She arched an eyebrow.
Is it now?
It assumes we have accurate foreknowledge of the future, which we don't. You can only make decisions based on the information you have at the time. We can't know that any of us will die.
Experience helps you with risk assessment, though. Crossing the street, you're probably safe. Going into a region of the Congo jungle controlled by warlords, not so much. And that wasn't a hypothetical. I did it. And it was a mistake. A terrible one. I hope none of you ever do the same.
The room fell silent for a moment. Again, Cheng spoke first.
I have a hypothetical I'd like to put to you, Professor.
She nodded.
Go on.
Suppose you believed you had evidence of a civilization millennia older than anything currently known. The evidence isn't yet definitive enough to convince mainstream archaeologists, but you're certain you'll confirm it if you're given the chance to mount an expedition.
Nina grinned.
That sounds familiar. That was how you found Atlantis, wasn't it?
Said Madison.
Yeah. Extra credit for reading my first book.
Cheng waited for the laughter to subside.
This isn't about Atlantis, though. What if it was a completely unknown civilization? The product of an extinct race, related to but separate from humans. A discovery like that would shatter the foundations of almost every religion, especially the Abrahamic ones, where the Book of Genesis is regarded as the literal truth.
The round-faced young man regarded her intently through his glasses.
Would you still try to find it?
Nina became uncomfortable. He was describing with unnerving accuracy a situation she had already experienced, and she was still not sure her eventual solution had been the right one.
I would have to give that a great deal of thought,
she said, trying not to sound defensive.
It would be possibly the most groundbreaking discovery in archaeological history. But on the other hand, it would be telling over 3 billion Christians, Jews, and Muslims that the entire basis of their belief system is untrue, to say nothing of the non-Abrahamic religions it would impact. And some people get very angry if their beliefs are challenged. Wars have started over less. So, in your hypothetical situation, I would be very, very careful about how I revealed what I'd found.
She watched for any indication that he somehow knew the truth about events 14 years earlier, but instead he cocked his head quizzically.
So you would try to find it?
Amusement ran around the room, the students enjoying that one of them had caught out a professor.
As I said, Nina replied, irked, I'd give it a lot of thought. At one time, I would have gone looking for it, yes. Now, I'd be a lot more cautious. Rushing into things gets people killed. And that's not a hypothetical answer.
Her discomfiture at Cheng's question meant the end of class soon afterwards came as a relief.
So, Professor Wilde, said Aidan, what are your other rules of archaeology?
There's only one more, Nina replied with a half smile. And it's simple.
Try not to blow everything up.
You need a rule for that?
Asked Madison.
You'd be surprised.
She gathered her belongings, noticing Cheng leaving in a hurry. She couldn't dispel her suspicion that he knew about her encounter with the religious organization known as the Covenant of Genesis. But how could that be possible? She had, with great reluctance, agreed to keep her knowledge of the ancient race known as the Vatares a secret for exactly the reason she had given. Not that it ultimately had mattered. All evidence of their existence had been destroyed, and every member of the Covenant itself was dead. Coincidence, she decided as she headed out. There were already numerous theories about ancient precursor races on the kookier fringes of the archaeological world. Cheng had just come up with his own take. Nothing to be concerned about. That thought lasted for as long as it took her to reach her office, outside which Cheng was waiting.
Can I help you, Mr. Hui?
Actually, yes, Professor,
the young man replied, almost twitching with eagerness. He glanced up and down the corridor.
But in private?
She decided to humor him.
Come on in.
Her office on the 9th floor of Columbia University's Schermerhorn extension overlooked Amsterdam Avenue, traffic noise rising from the street below. A lifelong New Yorker, Nina had long ago tuned it out. She sat at her desk and gestured to a chair.
So, what have you got?
I didn't want to say anything in front of the others,
he said, sitting.
Partly because I didn't want everyone to make fun of me, but also because if it's real, it could be an even bigger discovery than Atlantis. I think I found what I was talking about in class. Evidence of a civilization that existed before humans.
She gave him a deliberately non-committal nod.
I'm listening.
He opened his laptop, a new, sleek, and she guessed, very expensive model.
Okay. There are places on the dark web where people buy and sell stolen antiquities.
I know.
Certain corners of the internet were home to all manner of criminal activity, relying upon encryption, anonymity, and obscurity to hide from law enforcement. Unlike the mainstream internet, it was impossible to find such sites using a search engine. Access was by invitation only, buyers and sellers of looted items using near untraceable cryptocurrencies to cover their financial tracks.
It's a real problem. I managed to get into one of the sites. I pretended to make friends with someone involved and bought a password,
Cheng explained.
I was looking for stolen Chinese artifacts so I could tell the authorities. But instead, I found this.
He turned the screen to show her. It was a picture of a metal object, a golden disc. At its center was a circle of stone and crystal. Nina didn't recognize it, but she did recognize what was scribed into its surface. She tried to conceal her alarm. The symbols looked very much like the written language of the Vatares.
Well, that's an interesting piece. What is it?
I don't know. The seller, who's in Germany, called it a key, but didn't say much more. I don't think he knows much more. I suspect he stole it. But I've believed for a long time there was a much earlier civilization than anything we currently know. I think this is proof.
She raised an eyebrow. A long time? How old are you, Mr. Hui?
18, Professor.
And you've been challenging the archaeological establishment since puberty? She immediately felt almost guilty at the jibe. It was the kind of dismissal she had faced early in her own career.
I've always wanted to be an archaeologist, Professor,
said Cheng, not quite hiding a frown.
Just because I'm young doesn't mean I haven't worked hard.
Of course not. My apologies.
But if there's any evidence of a non-human precursor civilization, I'm not aware of it. He gave her a probing look.
I studied the mythologies of the Hebrews, the Hindus, my own country. There are many common aspects, even when they describe fantastical things. Shared legends. And you've proved many times that legends can be based on reality. Atlantis, Hercules, King Arthur, the angels of the Book of Revelation. You found them all. I think this,
he indicated the item on the screen,
is another one. And it'll prove my theory when I obtain it.
Jumping the gun a little, aren't you?
No, I've been in contact with the seller. I'm going to Hamburg to buy it.
What?
Said Nina, alarm returning for a different reason.
Ethical considerations aside, that's insanely dangerous. People selling stolen artifacts on the dark web are by definition criminals. There's a good chance they'll take your money and give you nothing. But if you meet them in person, they might give you something, a beating.
How much does the seller want?
50,000 euros.
The reply was matter of fact. She was shocked by both the amount and his insouciance.
50,000? And you're planning to pay it?
My family is rich.
You know what else rich families pay? Ransoms.
He seems trustworthy,
Cheng insisted.
Con men always do, right up until they disappear with your money.
A grim thought.
Please tell me you're not planning to pay this guy in cash.
His hesitation was answer enough.
You might as well go dressed as a lamb with a sign saying, "Hello, wolves."
But the artifact will prove my theory.
He indicated the symbols upon it.
This language is completely unknown. It's valuable for that alone. But if it really did come from an ancient race, it could lead me to them.
Or you might be risking your own neck for nothing. Remember my first rule?
You took greater risks to find Atlantis.
Yeah, and as I said, a lot of them were mistakes.
But you still found Atlantis. Would you give that up?
What's done is done,
Nina told him.
But now I want to keep other people from making the same mistakes. Or bigger ones.
Cheng sat silently for a moment.
I'm sorry, Professor Wilde, but I really have to do this,
he said finally.
I'd hoped you might even come with me, but I guess I'll have to go on my own.
He closed the laptop. Exasperated, Nina shook her head.
I can't stop you, but I can seriously advise against it.
If I don't go, the artifact will probably disappear into someone's private collection, or be melted down for the gold. The seller told me others are interested.
He's only saying that so he can jack up the price.
The price hasn't changed. I can fly to Germany to see him this weekend.
He gave her a pleading look.
If the artifact is shown by testing to be older than Atlantis, would you be willing to hear my theory?
Mr. Hui, if you make it to my class on Monday, I'll be willing to hear your theory, she said. I think going to Hamburg alone with 50,000 euros in cash to meet a criminal you contacted on the dark web is a spectacularly bad idea. Please don't do it.
I'll be fine,
he insisted as he stood.
Just because I'm young doesn't mean I'm naive.
He smiled.
I'll see you on Monday, and I'll have the artifact.
He took out a folded piece of paper and put it on her desk.
The dark web address and password for the site where I found it. If you look, I hope you'll be convinced it's worth obtaining. Thank you for your time, Professor.
He left. Nina blew out a frustrated breath. It was Wednesday now. Knowing he was conscientious about attending lectures, she imagined Cheng would probably fly out on Friday night, arriving in Hamburg on Saturday. And then who knew what might happen? His protestations aside, everything about the chubby young Chinese screamed innocent abroad. Some criminal in a notorious port town
was doubtless already licking his lips at the prospect of an extremely easy 50,000 euros at the very least.
At least leave him his kidneys,
she silently willed the universe. Losing one of her students would not go down well with the university. But what could she do? Threaten him with bad grades or expulsion? If his parents were as wealthy as she'd heard, that would only invite a lawsuit, which her bosses would take just as badly. And Hui Cheng was an adult, responsible for his own actions. If he wanted to go, she couldn't stop him. Could she? That thought kept rolling around her mind, even as she headed home, distracting her from the big night to come. Chapter 2
Happy birthday, Daddy,
trilled Macy Wilde Chase. The sentiment was echoed by the others around the restaurant's table. Macy's father was considerably less enthused.
Yeah, loads to be happy about, groused Eddie Chase. Me hair's gone, me eyesight's going, I'm half deaf, and the worst part is, I'll never feel this good again.
The guests at the birthday dinner laughed.
Look at it this way, honey, Nina told him. You've got all your body parts. You've got your friends. You've got your family. And you've got an amazing daughter. When I get to 50, I'll feel pretty thankful to have all that.
Eddie gave her a half smile.
Careful what you wish for. When you get to 50, Macy will be 15 and she'll hate you.
No, I won't, Mom,
Macy insisted. He looked to his sister for support.
Sorry, Nina,
said Elizabeth Chase.
I remember when Holly was 15, and oh, there's so much I'd rather forget.
Holly Bennett, now twice that age, nodded.
Afraid it's true.
Unlike her uncle, who had retained his gruff Yorkshire accent after 17 years in the United States, she had developed a transatlantic twang after only 2 years working in New York. Nina pouted.
Well, enough about me. Everyone can pile back onto Eddie now.
Eddie's father, Larry Chase, clapped his hands.
We can. Excellent.
His wife, Julie, jabbed him with an elbow. Ha! Eddie exclaimed before standing.
I didn't want to make a big deal of turning 50, but Nina went behind my back to organise this do. And I'm glad she did. I've no idea so many of you would come such a long-ass way just to say happy birthday to a bald bloke from Big House.
He gestured at his friends.
I mean, we got people from Israel, Russia, Brazil, the Congo, even bloody Australia. It's a real honour to see you all.
Our pleasure, mate,
said the Australian, Matt Truly. He was here with his husband, Pat.
I mean, you've saved the world a few times. Least we could do in return.
And you've saved me and Nina a few times, so thank you all. Cheers.
Eddie raised his glass, the other guests following suit.
Now, enjoy the food. Should be good. It's costing enough.
Everyone laughed.
Yorkshiremen never change,
said Julie to Nina as Eddie sat.
Short arms and long pockets. That's the saying, isn't it? At least that's what his father says about them.
Larry, originally from Buckinghamshire in southern England, gave his northern-born son a mocking smile. Nina grinned.
Tell me about it.
I'm not wrong, though, am I?
Said Eddie. He picked up a menu.
I mean, how much just for garlic bread? Oh, bloody hell.
He frowned, having to hold it almost at arm's length to read the words.
You see what I mean about getting old? Everything either stops working or starts hurting. Pain in the arse. Sometimes literally.
Nina's grandmother, Olivia Wilde, tutted.
Really, Eddie? Of all the things you might be, I've never thought of you as a whiner. I'm almost twice your age, and do you know what I've learned?
Never eat prunes after a curry,
suggested Eddie with a smirk.
Something else I've never thought of you as is a comedian,
Olivia replied, unfazed.
But age isn't important. It's attitude. How well you live matters more than simply how long. I spent the prime of my life focused on entirely the wrong things. And it wasn't until I met Nina and reconnected with my family a few years ago that I realized how empty that was. Now, I'm 96 and certainly not expecting to make it to 100.
Don't say that, Grams,
Macy cut in.
Well, it's true. But I'm happier than I was before. Frailties be damned. And it's not as if I'm sitting around waiting to die. I don't worry that I've done everything I ever will. I look forward to what I'm still gonna do. You should do the same.
She's right, said Nina. You've done so much already.
Like Matt said, you've saved the world. Several times. But just because you've got nothing left to prove doesn't mean you've got nothing left to achieve. You've certainly achieved a lot, Nina, said Elizabeth. Congratulations on your professorship, if that's the right word. Thanks, yeah. I went full circle and ended up back at my alma mater. It must be a change teaching instead of being out in the field. It is. I don't know which is more scary, facing a bad guy with a gun or 50 new students all staring at you.
Chuckles from around the table.
I do prefer the quiet life, though.
You're not tempted to go back out on one last big adventure?
Asked the Israeli, Jared Zane.
I'm not planning to, no. Research and teaching is a full-time job.
Elizabeth turned to Macy.
And I've heard you want to follow in your mum's footsteps and become an archaeologist too.
The young redhead nodded.
Yeah, Mom thinks she's found everything there is, but I know there's more out there, so I'm going to find it.
She wants to prove me wrong, Nina sighed. 10 years old and already she's out to torpedo my professional reputation.
Macy narrowed her eyes.
You are wrong, Mom. I know what happened with the Trican, even if you don't believe me. The Trican?
Asked Elizabeth.
An Atlantean artifact,
Nina explained.
Similar to a yo-yo. It's a weapon, although nobody's been able to figure out how it works. At least, she added, until Macy claimed she got it to do all kinds of physics-defying tricks. I did do it,
Macy said, glaring at her.
I made it change direction in midair, just by wanting it to. That's what it does in the movies, not real life.
Her glare deepened.
You always say that. But I can tell the difference between a movie and real life. I'm not stupid.
I don't think you'll have to wait until she's 15, love,
said Eddie, amused, before addressing his friends.
Now I know what Nina must have been like as a kid. Macy's always reading about some ancient thing or other, or watching documentaries.
I wouldn't call them documentaries, Nina said snippily. Anything involving UFOs or ancient astronauts or demons is junk science. Nothing more.
Didn't people used to think that about Atlantis?
Nina gave him a stony look, which brought a broad grin in return.
Anyway, let's talk about something else before my wife and daughter get into a fight. So, are you going to change your life now you are 50?
Asked the Congolese fortune bimber.
Somehow, I cannot imagine Eddie Chase spending the rest of his days relaxing in a hammock. If we had a garden, I'd have a hammock in it already,
Eddie told him.
Nah, as far as running around the world dodging bullets goes, I'm done. Don't want to tempt fate by looking for trouble again.
Fortune nodded.
Good luck with your quiet life, my friend.
That was enough excuse for another toast.
Good luck,
chorused Brazilian ex-cop Ana Rio and her boyfriend, the hulking Russian mercenary Oleg Maximov. Everyone else followed suit. Eddie and Nina clinked their own glasses.
Sounds good to me, he said.
You?
Staying out of trouble,
she said.
Absolutely. Here's to a quiet life.
They both drank. Then Nina eyed her husband's faintly pensive expression.
What is it?
Cannot think it. I'm going to hear Ron Howard's voice saying, they didn't get one.
She laughed.
A cultural reference from the 21st century. I'm impressed. But we don't need to worry. I mean, I'm not about to jet off around the world looking for some ancient artifact. Honey,
said Nina a few hours later.
You remember how I said I wasn't about to jet off around the world looking for some ancient artifact?
Yeah,
Eddie replied, followed by a more forceful,
Oh, you're bloody kidding me.
I know. But something's come up.
He entered her study, giving her a stern look as he folded his arms.
What?
She turned from her laptop to face him. The mysterious artifact Cheng had shown her dominated the screen. After returning home, she'd found the paper he'd given her in her purse. Out of a mixture of intrigue and concern for his welfare, and maybe with the encouragement of a few drinks, she had installed an anonymizing Tor browser so she could access the dark web, then used the address and password to reach the seller's page. What she found caught her interest, almost unwillingly. There was a more detailed description of the object in both German and English, the text hinting at its origin. Obtained near the South Pole.
The hidden redoubt of the Viteras had been in the Antarctic. There had to be a connection. Then there were the crystal and the purple stone at the disk's center. They appeared to be the same materials as ones she had found in an Atlantean vault buried in Turkey. Materials that, in conjunction with the Earth's natural energy fields, produced strange, even dangerous effects. She knew from unpleasant experience that the Viteras, like their distant descendants from Atlantis, could harness these powers. A key, the seller called it. But to what?
This is something one of my students found on the dark web, she explained. It's almost certainly a Vitara's artifact.
I thought everything of theirs was destroyed.
So did I.
But it seems history always finds a way to resurface. She indicated part of the picture.
This text looks like the same script from the Vitara's records in Antarctica.
What about that?
He nodded at a smaller image.
Badly drawn pirates.
The second photo showed a highly stylized skull.
I don't know what it represents, but the text around it is in a different language. It almost looks Atlantean.
This thing's from Atlantis?
I don't know. The characters don't quite match, and some of them I don't even recognize. It could be an earlier form. Proto-Atlantean.
Can you read any of it?
She nodded.
This word. If it were written in Atlantean, I'd say it was rebirth or resurrection. I can't translate anything else, though. Maybe if I saw the real thing.
Which is where?
Germany. Somebody's trying to sell it on the black market.
He peered at the screen.
50 grand? Jesus, who'd pay that much?
My student, unfortunately. A Chinese kid called Chang with a wealthy family. He wanted me to go with him to buy it.
By you?
I'm his professor, and I have a track record of finding lost civilizations, remember? But when I said no, he decided he was going anyway. And I think he's going to be played for a sucker to the tune of 50,000 euros at best, and end up face down in the River Elbe at worst.
You don't think it's genuine?
No, I do. And that's the problem. If some kid can find it on the dark web, so can other people.
She pointed out the stone and crystal.
These are the same kind of things we saw in Turkey. Remember how somebody stole the entire vault from under the noses of the Turkish government and the IHA?
Hard to forget. The thing probably weighed 20 tons.
Any group that could do that would have to be big, well-connected. Somebody in Turkey must have turned a blind eye. And rich. It was a huge job. But they did it literally overnight, without leaving a single clue. An organization like that won't let a nerdy 18-year-old beat them to the punch.
What kind of organization, though? He asked. Everybody in the Covenant of Genesis is dead, and they were the only ones who knew all about the Viteras. And the vault in Turkey was from Atlantis, not from Viteras.
But they're linked. Both civilizations could channel Earth energy. We already know that's a power the American government would go to great lengths to obtain. Never mind any other country.
Eddie pursed his lips thoughtfully.
And you said this kid is Chinese? There's a country that's trying pretty damn hard to get more power all around the world. Maybe he's working for the Chinese government.
She gave him a mocking look.
Cheng's 18, and I'd guess the most physical training he's ever had was clicking a mouse. I really don't think he's a Chinese spy. I'm more worried about him going to Hamburg chasing this thing and not returning.
So you want to chase after it instead?
I can't stop him going, she said. But I can make sure he comes back.
Eddie perched on the edge of her desk, then sighed.
So much for the quiet life. That lasted, what, 3 hours?
I know, she said. It wasn't what I planned at all. But if Cheng goes on his own, I have a horrible feeling he'll be sticking his head in a lion's mouth. He's clever, very smart, but, well, he's still a kid.
He made a disapproving noise, then looked back at the screen.
Hamburg, eh? I've been there. Long time back when I was in the army, but I doubt it's changed much. Sort of place where you need to stay on your toes.
Any advice?
Don't go on your own, especially in the rough part of town, which is where I can guarantee the guy selling this thing will be.
Yeah, I'd already resigned myself to that, she said with dark humour.
When's it going?
This weekend.
And I already know I won't talk you out of going with him, because you're back in full Nina mode.
Eddie straightened.
I'll come with you, he said firmly.
Nina knew he would be as stubborn having made the decision as she, but still gave him a dubious look.
What about Macy?
Ollie or Olivia can look after her.
Macy will be pissed at us both, you know.
He grinned.
You should be used to that by now.
It was her turn to sigh.
I know. Oh, well, better start thinking about how we're going to break this to her in the morning.
I think we'll have to work faster than that, said Eddie,
as the study door opened. Macy entered.
Break what to me?
All yours, love,
the auctioneer said to Nina with a grin.
Gee, thanks,
she replied, before taking a deep breath as she faced her daughter.
Okay. Honey, this weekend, your dad and I have to go away for a couple of days. Why?
Macy asked.
Some business came up at the university. I need to go to Germany to help collect an artifact.
Her face lit up.
Can I come? Sorry, honey, but no. You'll have to stay here.
Macy's smile turned instantly into a scowl.
What? Why? Why does Dad get to go but not me?
Nina looked to Eddie for help, but he merely gave her an infuriating little smirk. She glared at him, then continued.
The place we're probably going, it's not really suitable for a girl your age.
A snort of outrage.
Mom! I'm 10, not 5!
Eddie finally joined in.
To be honest, love, I wouldn't be happy about you going there, even if you were a grown-up.
Macy's expression did not lighten.
I can't believe you're going to Europe without me. We'll be back as soon as we can,
Nina assured her.
Olivia and Holly will look after you while we're gone. But I don't want them to look after me,
she protested.
I want to come with you.
She glanced at Nina's laptop.
What's that? That's the artifact we're going to collect. That skull looks familiar. I think I've seen it in an archaeology video. I doubt it, honey,
Nina said.
This thing's only just been discovered.
Macy's only reply was an irritable huff as she turned and stalked out. Her mother and father exchanged long-suffering glances, then followed her into the living room.
It'll be okay, love, said Eddie. It's only for 2 nights, and I'm sure Holly and Olivia will do something fun with you.
Holly only ever offers to take me to the zoo, like I'm still 6,
Macy complained. She picked up her toy trican, based on the weapon from the movies rather than the real artifact, from the coffee table.
And I love Olivia, but she's really old. She can't do anything fun.
Nina sighed.
My little girl's already turning into a teenager, and she's only 10,
she said to Eddie, before turning back to her daughter.
So what do you want to do?
A shrug.
I don't know.
Yep, definitely sounds like a teenager, Eddie said.
Macy pouted, spinning the trican on a short length of its string like a yo-yo, then whirled towards Eddie and sent it flying at him.
Hey, Malkovich, think fast!
It was a family joke from the film Being John Malkovich, warning that the other person should duck. Eddie did so, but not quickly enough. The toy deflected off the top of his head as he bobbed, hitting an ornament on a shelf. It fell to the floor and smashed. Macy gasped in dismay. Eddie stared at the broken pieces aghast. Nina, meanwhile, had to use every ounce of self-control not to whoop in delight.
Oh, no, she managed. That's a shame.
The broken object was a pottery cigar box holder in the caricatured shape of a beaming Fidel Castro, which had come with the Englishman when the couple first moved in together, and which Nina had long since abandoned hope of ever removing from their home. She tried not to smile about their daughter doing it for her. Eddie regarded the debris for one last moment, then, with a heavy breath, crouched to collect the fragments.
Oh, Dad, no, I'm so sorry,
Macy cried, kneeling to help him.
Can you fix it?
No, it's bust, he said, shaking his head. Oh, well, guess it did its job.
As far as Nina knew, it had never held a cigar in its life, and she was sure he didn't mean its everyday purpose of storing loose change.
What do you mean?
Didn't I tell you where it came from?
I always kind of suspected Cuba, but no.
Hugo gave it me as a souvenir while we were doing a job in Cuba, yeah.
He nodded towards the framed pictures occupying part of one wall, Eddie's former comrades in arms, many of whom are now dead. Hugo Castile had been his closest friend during his time as an international troubleshooter.
We actually met Castro, you know,
he added, almost as an afterthought. Nina was surprised.
Her husband had always been discreet about his military and mercenary past, but never mentioning that.
You did?
Yeah, briefly. One of those, how the hell did I get into this situation moments. Didn't agree with his politics, but he was a funny guy.
He finished gathering the larger pieces and put them in the bin.
I'll get the vacuum,
said Macy, hurrying to the hall cupboard.
So Hugo bought me this,
Eddie went on, crouching again to collect the spilled coins.
Partly as a joke about meeting Fidel, and partly to say, hey, don't sit around moping about the past. I've just got divorced. Because you never know what's going to happen next. And that part was certainly true. After me and Sophia split up, I had a couple of years doing all sorts of crazy stuff. And then I met you.
And then things got really crazy,
she said with a smile. Not bloody kidding, he replied, grinning, as Macy returned with the vacuum cleaner.
So maybe poor old Fidel's done everything he was meant to do. I've reached 50, so that's one chapter of my life over. But there are new ones to come.
Lots and lots of them, hopefully.
Well, that's the plan.
He deposited the coins on a countertop, then moved so Macy could vacuum up the remaining fragments.
Can't believe I didn't duck in time.
Like you said, you've reached 50,
Nina reminded him.
You aren't as quick as when you were 20.
Well, 49, apparently. Thanks, Macy.
Macy switched off the vacuum cleaner.
Dad, I'm sorry I broke it. I really am.
It's all right, love, he said, squeezing her. It's just a thing. Nobody got hurt. So,
he went on, recognizing an opportunity.
Do you think you'll be okay without us for a couple of days?
I suppose so, yeah.
Macy gave him a sidelong look, realizing she had been guilt-tripped.
Dad.
He grinned.
You'll be fine. We'll call Holly and Olivia in the morning.
And I'll tell Chang we're going with him,
added Nina. Eddie let out a wry chuckle.
Off to Germany at a moment's notice. Hugo was right. You never do know what's going to happen next.
Chapter 3. Hamburg, Germany. Cheng looked around as he, Nina, and Eddie emerged from the S-Bahn station.
So, this is the famous Reeperbahn.
Infamous is more like it, said Eddie. It doesn't look like much in daylight, but things will kick off once it gets dark. And whatever you do, keep hold of that bloody bag.
As well as a backpack, the young Chinese carried a black nylon holdall. In it was 50,000 euros in cash, which he had collected from a bank in central Hamburg. Nina was already regretting her decision to come. The evening flight from JFK had been delayed, not taking off until the early hours of the morning. And when she called Macy on arriving in Germany, her daughter was still angry and petulant about being forced to stay at home. The knowledge that they still had to deal with the artifact seller, who she was certain would try to pull some con, did not improve her own grumpy mood.
Do I want to know what you were doing in Hamburg's red light district?
Nothing I caught anything from, don't worry,
her husband replied with a grin.
It's pretty much a squaddy rule when you're in Germany. Come to Hamburg, go to the Reeperbahn, drink too much, ogle people, try not to pass out in a gutter and wake up with all your money gone. Hey, I was young,
he added, seeing her disapproval.
I didn't do anything like that when I was young.
Maybe you should have. Might have made you more adventurous.
He waggled his eyebrows suggestively. Nina felt her cheeks flush.
Eddie, we have company.
He's not listening.
Cheng was consulting a map on his phone, only to become distracted as two young women wearing extremely short skirts and high heels trotted past.
Hey, Cheng! Close your mouth, you're drooling.
The Chinese student hurriedly snapped his jaw shut.
I was not. I was,
I'm guessing you haven't seen anything like this in China,
said Nina. The buildings along the Reeperbahn advertised their business with Teutonic bluntness. Most were dedicated to sex, all tastes and kinks and fetishes catered for, and the remainder provided sustenance and supplies to wide-eyed visitors.
I have to admit, no, Professor,
said Cheng, forcing his eyes back to the phone.
So where are we going? Eddie asked.
He told me to come to an apartment off a street called Grob Freiheit at 7 o'clock.
The Yorkshireman laughed.
That's Grosse Freiheit. Pronounced like grocer?
You know it,
said Nina.
Yeah, lots of boozers and nightclubs and theatres.
Not the kind that do Shakespeare, I assume.
topless Shakespeare, maybe.
He pointed west.
It's along there.
The trio started down the street. The Reaper barn was switching from daytime mundanity to the excitement of the night, or the sleaze, depending on one's point of view. Nina definitely veered towards the latter. Packs of young male tourists were heading for the bars to drink up the courage they needed to enter somewhere more exotic. Older men in ones and twos moving purposefully towards whichever establishment catered to their evening's desires. Female visitors were in the minority, and were either in groups for mutual reassurance, or tagging along uncomfortably with partners. The women who actually worked in the district, whatever their age and profession, all had similar expressions, a stony indifference that couldn't quite be masked even behind the brightest fake smile.
"Is it safe here?" she asked, moving closer to Eddie.
"Lots of cops about," he replied. "This is a big tourist attraction. They don't let anyone cause trouble."
She wasn't reassured. They passed sex shops and porn cinemas and greasy-smelling fast food joints, eventually coming to a circular plaza at an intersection.
"Ooh, I've heard about this," said Eddie with enthusiasm.
The metal outlines of five figures stood around the circle. All held musical instruments, four guitars and one set of drums.
"Who are they?"
Nina asked.
"It's the Beatles, John, Paul, George and Ringo. They played in clubs here before they got famous."
He stood behind one of the guitarists, striking a matching pose with an air instrument. She looked at the lonely fifth figure.
"So who's that?"
"Stuart Sutcliffe, or Pete Best. One of the fifth Beatles."
Cheng regarded the statues with curiosity.
"What are the Beatles?"
Eddie gave him an incredulous look.
"You've never heard of the Beatles?"
"No."
"One of the most famous bands of all time?"
He shook his head.
"Oh, sorry, Mr. Chase, I don't know them."
Nina laughed.
"Eddie, he was only born 18 years ago. It'd be like expecting you to know the big names in pre-war jazz."
"That's why I feel old,"
the Englishman complained, before facing a street leading north.
"Anyway, that's Grosser Freiheit. Where exactly are we going?"
Cheng examined his map again.
"Behind a theatre near the far end. There's an alley next to a bar."
"A back alley in a red light district. Yeah, that sounds safe," said Nina as they set off again.
"I'll watch out for you both," Eddie assured her.
They made their way up the Grosser Freiheit. The bustling street was even more open than the Reaper barn about its trade. Neon blazed, flashing signs and loud music, trying to entice punters into the bars and clubs and shows. The couple noticed with amusement that Cheng was trying desperately not to gawp at the more outre passers-by. Thigh-booted women and transvestites, a bare-chested man in leather trousers and a bright pink pimp hat, complete with peacock feather, a man and woman dressed head to foot in shiny black rubber and bondage harnesses.
"See anything you like,"
Eddie joked.
"No, no,"
Cheng mumbled, redirecting his gaze towards his feet.
"Where's this alley?"
Nina asked. He checked the phone.
"Next to a bar called Faustus?"
Eddie chuckled.
"Guess it's a gay bar, then."
"Why?"
"Faust is German for fist, so it's literally called Fisters."
The young man was puzzled, then his eyes popped wide as he realised the meaning.
"Oh, but we don't need to go inside,"
he stammered.
"You don't want to expand your horizons, and other things."
"Eddie,"
Nina chided, seeing Cheng's embarrassment deepen. Her husband laughed again. Faustus was not hard to find. Its neon sign was in the shape of a clenched fist surrounded by a heart. A theatre across the alley beside it was emblazoned with posters for drag acts.
"This is it,"
said Cheng. Eddie looked down the narrow passage. A couple of theatre employees were smoking outside a side entrance.
"It'll look safe. But I'll go first anyway."
He led the way.
"How do we find this guy?"
Nina asked.
"Oh, there's an apartment block behind the theatre. He's in number 5.
They rounded a corner, entering a small courtyard. Nina crinkled her nose at the stench from a pile of garbage bags atop an overloaded dumpster. Cheng led them to a doorway beside it.
"Nice," she said. "I don't know how people could live here. Never mind the smell, listen to the noise."
Thudding bass lines from the theatre and bar competed in volume.
"If you live here, you're probably working nights," said Eddie. "Or so desperate for a roof over your head that you don't care.
or you're the kind of person who sells stolen artifacts over the dark web. Let's see if he's home.
Tring pushed an intercom button. A pause, then a curt, "Yeah," came from the speaker.
"Hello," he said. "It's Hui Cheng."
Someone peered down from a window. Then the voice returned,
"Come in."
A lock released with a clack. Eddie opened the door. A motion-activated light flicked on, revealing a cramped and grubby hall. He led them up the narrow staircase to the first landing.
"Here, number 5.
He rapped on the door. A man peered warily out before swinging it wider.
"In, in,"
he said, gesturing impatiently. They entered an untidy studio overlooking the courtyard, a single bed in one corner. The man, a weather-beaten 30-something with a scruffy beard, regarded the trio suspiciously before turning to Cheng.
"You are Hui, yes?"
Cheng nodded.
"Yes."
"The eyes give it away."
He looked at Nina.
"And I can tell from the tits that you are Nina Wilde."
Eddie glared at him.
"And you can tell from my fish that you'll have no teeth if you talk to my wife like that again."
"Who are you?"
"Her husband, obviously."
Nina thought the man was about to object to Eddie's presence, but then he turned back to Cheng, eyeing his bag.
"You have some money?"
"You have the artifact?"
she countered.
"Of course. Show me the money, and you can see it."
Nina exchanged a look with Eddie. Neither of them remotely trusted their host, but Cheng unzipped the holdall, revealing bundles of 200-euro notes. The man stared greedily at them, then smiled.
"Jakob Kramer, good to meet you."
"Likewise, I'm sure," Nina replied sarcastically. "You've seen what you want, now show us what you've got."
Kramer gave the money another hungry look, then slid a canvas duffel bag from beneath the bed. He withdrew a tightly bound bundle of clothes, which he started to unwrap.
"I suppose you want to know where it came from."
"It'd help, yeah."
"I was crew on a cargo ship going from New Zealand to South Africa. We answered a distress call and found a man on an ice floe. He was carrying this."
"You stole it," said Nina, appalled. "You rescued this guy, then robbed him?"
"The man is insane. He had no use for it. He was screaming about demons."
"You said is insane," Eddie noted. "Present tense."
"He's still alive?"
Nina asked.
Kramer nodded. "He's in a mental hospital in Holland. Still crazy."
"What, you checked up on him to make sure he won't tell anyone about what you stole?"
The German ignored her, peeling away the last of the clothing.
"Here it is. The key."
He held it up. The artifact was bigger than Nina had thought, about 9 inches across. Even in the low light, she instantly knew from the metal's reddish gleam that it was the gold alloy the Atlanteans called auriculum.
"The key to what?"
"He did not say."
"What did he say?"
"Not much. As I told you, he's insane. He said a demon frozen in the ice woke up and killed his shipmates. His ship must have sunk because we did not see it."
Nina frowned.
"A demon?"
"That is what he said. So he must be crazy, yeah? There's no such thing."
Kramer lowered the key.
"Now, it is time to talk business. You still want to buy it?"
"Ah, yes,"
said Cheng.
"Then you'll surely be willing to pay a little extra money."
Eddie rolled his eyes.
"Oh, here we go."
The color drained from Cheng's face.
"But we had a deal. There are others interested. But you were the first, so I will be fair and give you the chance to buy it now."
Nina regarded him coldly.
"How much do you want?"
100,000 euros.
Cheng blinked. Nina blanched. Eddie laughed.
"You're taking the piss," exclaimed the Yorkshireman. "That's twice what you were asking."
"If the famous Nina Wilde is willing to come to Germany to see it, it must be more valuable than I thought. If you want it, you will pay what I ask."
I can't get the money,"
said Cheng, flustered.
"But I don't know how long it will take. I have to call China, talk to my family."
Nina found herself saying words that surprised even her.
"I can pay the rest."
"You what?"
Eddie erupted.
"We can afford it. And this artifact looks genuine, which means it's worth every penny."
Kramer looked at the key.
"Then perhaps I should ask even more."
"Perhaps you should ask for a boot up your ass,"
the Englishman snapped.
"Nina, are you out of your bloody mind? 50 grand? That's like giving him Macy's college fund.
I don't think you appreciate just how much an Ivy League education costs.
But she was already wavering. Eddie was right. Without the financial backing of the university or her former employer, the International Heritage Agency, she would effectively be taking money from her family to indulge her archaeological curiosity. The thought of Macy swayed her.
No, you're right, she admitted.
That was a dumb idea. I think younger me took over for a moment. Sorry, Mr. Kramer, but I've changed my mind.
The sailor was taken aback.
If you do not buy it now, I will sell it to someone else, he insisted.
And then you'll try to stiff them too? Dangerous business.
Yeah, Eddie rumbled. You might try it on someone who isn't as nice as us.
I can get the money,
Chang insisted. He raised his phone.
I will call now.
Nina put her hand over it.
Chang, no. We should leave.
He looked at her in surprise.
But the key! It could prove my theory.
She'd already had similar thoughts. The artifact could be new evidence of a civilization that long predated humanity. But that was a can of worms she was unsure she wanted to reopen. And besides, a little voice at the back of her mind warned that Kramer was full of shit.
It might or it might not, she told the Chinese youth.
But this guy, this thief, is just out to rip you off. I don't believe there are any other buyers at all. Maybe we should set the price. And it'll be a damn sight less than 50,000 euros.
Easy way to find out, said Eddie. We'll go and see how long it takes him to call us back.
No, I can't get the money, said Cheng. I want to...
Mr. Wei,
Nina said firmly.
Do you want to pass my class?
Yes, but...
Then do what I tell you. Remember what I said about young people not listening to older people with the experience to know what the hell they're talking about? This is one of those times. Come on, we're going.
He huffed, summoning the courage to challenge her.
No! No, you can't make me!
She almost laughed.
Wow, it's like Macy came with us.
She might not be able to make you, said Eddie, but I can.
While the Yorkshireman was fairly stocky, he was still taller than Cheng, and he moved closer to loom over him.
Cheng, said Nina, let's go. Now.
She closed his bag, then started for the door. The young man reluctantly followed, Eddie behind him. Kramer scuttled to catch up.
Okay, we can still make a deal. 80,000. No, 75. I will be generous.
Nina ushered Cheng out.
Forget it.
No, wait.
Desperation entered the German's voice.
Okay, I will take the 50,000. A deal is a deal, yeah?
Deal with this,
said Eddie, flipping him the bird as he closed the door. They started down the stairs.
We can't just walk away,
Cheng protested.
Yeah, we can,
Nina replied. Below, three men entered the hall and headed upwards.
The guy was a total con man.
But he had the...
Cheng broke off as the first new arrival, a cold-faced blonde, pushed rudely past him, his companions doing the same. Nina and Eddie moved aside to let them through, but the stairway was so narrow they still brushed against each other.
Oh, excuse me,
the Yorkshireman shot after them. The leader gave him a contemptuous look.
Arseholes.
He had the key,
said Cheng, resuming his descent.
It's genuine. You said so yourself. It could lead us to a lost civilization. After everything you've discovered, how can you turn your back on that?
They exited the building.
Did you listen to a word I said in my lecture?
Nina demanded, stopping in the middle of the courtyard and facing him.
Yes, I've made some amazing discoveries. At a great cost. This might be about money, not lives, but I want my students to learn from my mistakes, not repeat them.
But I have the original 50,000 euros,
said Cheng, slapping the holdall.
We could go back and pay him. Then we'd have the key.
He'll call you again, I guarantee it. And this time, he'll want a lot less.
She broke off at raised voices from above. Eddie looked up, seeing shifting shadows behind a window.
Hey, oh, that's Kramer's flat.
Must be those guys who passed us on the stairs, said Nina. Maybe he really does have other potential buyers.
Ah!
They all leapt back in shock as Kramer was hurled through the window. Chapter 4. The screaming German landed with a bang on the overflowing dumpster. Nina whipped up her arms to shield herself from flying glass.
Jesus!
She looked up.
The blond man glared back from the window, then shouted to his companions,
"Find the key!"
Kramer slid off the dumpster. Nina hurried to him.
"Oh my God, are you okay?"
"Yeah,"
he gasped, squinting up at her, then slipping a hand out of his jacket. He still had the key.
"Help me. Eddie," she cried. "We gotta get him out of here."
Her husband sighed.
"So much for staying out of trouble."
Kramer's attacker had turned to watch the other men tear the squalid room apart. Then he whipped back around as Nina and Eddie brought the German to his feet.
"He still has it,"
he shouted.
"Get after him."
"Time to go,"
Eddie barked, shoving Kramer towards the alley. Nina followed.
"Chang, come on."
The young Chinese was frozen in bewilderment.
"But what is—"
She pulled him after her.
"Run!"
Eddie and Kramer hurried around the corner, still towing Chang. Nina glanced back to see the blonde man draw a suppressed pistol.
"Oh, shit! A gun!"
She yanked Chang into cover, the crack of a bullet striking brickwork just behind them almost drowned out the silenced weapon's flat chick. Eddie and Kramer were a few meters ahead, but the sailor could only manage a loping run, one leg hurt in the fall. The alley stretched towards the glare and noise of the Große Freiheit. If they could reach it, they could lose themselves in the crowd, or even find some cops. A loud crash from behind warned they wouldn't make it. The shooter had dropped down onto the dumpster. He would be able to take another shot before the fleeing group reached the street. Eddie realized the same thing and changed direction, shoving a startled smoker aside and pushing Kramer through the theater's side entrance.
"In here!"
Nina swept Cheng inside as the theater worker shouted after them. They were in the backstage area, loud music from the auditorium echoing through narrow passageways.
"Which way?"
"Dunno. Try here."
Eddie rounded a corner, the others following. Doors marked with peeling stick-on stars greeted them.
"Dressing rooms. We must be near the stage."
The smoker at the entrance shouted again, then cried out as he was clubbed down.
"He's coming,"
said Nina. Running footsteps echoed behind them. The corridor ended at two more doors, one a lavatory bearing a symbol of a male figure wearing a huge beehive wig. The other was ajar, bright lights beyond. The Yorkshireman barreled through. It was indeed a dressing room, illuminated mirrors along one wall and rack upon rack of showy female clothing against the other. A pink-haired drag queen gasped as the interlopers burst in.
"Sorry, excuse us,"
said Eddie as he hurried past.
"Nice wig."
There was an exit at the far end, but the pursuing footsteps were catching up fast.
"Go! Go!"
Nina shouted to Cheng as she halted. If she could jam the door with one of the racks. Too late. The blonde man was almost at the entrance. She snatched up a large container of face powder and hurled it into the hallway. The cardboard tub burst open like a smoke bomb, a dense cloud of flesh-toned powder erupting in front of her pursuer. He reflexively jumped back, coughing. Nina shoved a clothing rack at the doorway to block it, then ran after the others. Eddie reached the exit.
"Keep going,"
he barked, pushing Kramer and Cheng through before turning back to Nina.
"Come on, quick."
"I'm coming, I'm coming."
The cloud was already thinning. The man appeared in the blocked doorway just as she reached the exit. Eddie propelled her through, following as the gun snapped up and fired. The round struck woodwork in his wake, splinters stabbing at the back of his bald head. He shouted for the others to keep moving, but held position. The rattle of laden coat hangers told him the gunman was moving the clothing rack. He peeked around the door. The drag queen ducked fearfully under the countertop. Beyond her, the blonde man grunted in annoyance as he forced the heavy rack aside. He still held the gun. The Yorkshireman looked for anything that could even the odds. All that was within his reach was clothing and shoes. He snatched an item from the closest rack and withdrew as the gunman pushed into the room. It was Nina's turn to call for him to hurry. He waved for her to keep going, then looked back into the dressing room, using the mirrors to see without putting his head into the gunman's line of sight. He was taking a risk. If his opponent used the same trick to spot him, he could shoot him straight through the wooden wall. But his pursuer's gaze was fixed on the exit as he rushed past the drag queen. Eddie tensed, waiting for him to get closer, then attacked. The Yorkshireman spun out, swinging his weapon, a glossy black PVC thigh boot with a 6-inch platform and a 10-inch stiletto heel. The towering sole weighed well over a kilogram, striking the blonde's skull hard enough to send him reeling into the clothes racks. One of them toppled, burying him amongst its sequined and feathered wardrobe. Eddie hurled the boot at his head, drawing a yell of outraged pain. He looked for the gun. His adversary's right arm was pinned by the overturned rack. He threw clothing aside, trying to snatch the pistol from his hand. noises from the passageway. The downed man's comrades had caught up. Eddie instantly abandoned his search and ran through the exit. Nina waited at the top of a flight of stairs, Kramer and the panting Cheng beyond.
"What happened?"
she asked. He vaulted up the steps.
"I gave him the boot."
Her response to the feeble pun was a long-suffering sigh. Cheng's, on the other hand, was confusion.
"What do you mean?"
"I whacked his head with a kinky boot." "That's nothing,"
he added, on seeing the student's befuddlement.
"I once broke someone's jaw with a foot-long dildo."
"Not ours, I hasten to add," said Nina, as they hurried through some swing doors.
The music became louder. They were behind the stage, a couple of outrageously outfitted drag artists awaiting their cue. An illuminated green sign marked an emergency exit, but the way was blocked by a burly stagehand, who called to more men in the backstage area for support before running at them.
"I can't get out,"
gasped Cheng.
"Yeah, we can," Nina told him. "You ever wanted to take to the stage?"
Eddie hurried to a large casted prop chest.
"I'll catch up,"
he shouted, pushing the heavy box towards the stairwell. Nina raced past the waiting drag queens onto the stage. Cheng and Kramer followed. A trio of cross-dressing performers turned to usher them into their act, a blend of cabaret number and burlesque striptease, only to react with surprise when they saw the newcomers were not who they'd expected. The lead queen, clearly a seasoned professional well used to unexpected developments, immediately addressed them suggestively, arousing laughter from the audience.
Sorry, wrong turn,
Nina said, squinting into the spotlights to find an escape route. The central aisle was visible through the glare.
This way.
She jumped down, Kramer behind her. The German staggered on landing, his legs still hurt. Cheng didn't move, gawping transfixed at the performers. Specifically, their very revealing cleavages.
"Oh, for God's sake," Nina shouted. "They're not real. Get down here."
The young man blinked, then in a fluster, hurried after her. Eddie, meanwhile, had brought the chest to the top of the stairs, just as the blonde man and his comrades rushed out of the dressing room. The leader's gun came up. The Yorkshireman dropped on his back as a bullet cracked over him, then kicked the box hard over the top step. The pursuers frantically scrambled back as it cartwheeled to the floor and burst apart. Eddie jumped up and ran after Nina. The first stagehand tried to block him, but even many years after resigning from service, the former SAS man was more than capable of defending himself. Barely 2 seconds later, the German was on the floor, gasping. The other stagehands suddenly slowed, not wanting to join their co-worker. Eddie nodded to thank them for their good sense and ran onto the stage. His appearance drew a mocking introduction from the lead, something about liking bald men. He didn't understand the rest, but guessed it was rude, and more audience laughter. He gave her a bow, then leapt off the stage, seeing Nina and the others heading for the exit. It took less time than he liked to catch up, Kramer's legs slowing him.
"Keep moving!"
he shouted as they reached the doors. A look back. The blonde pursuer rushed out from the wings. The drag queen began another sarcastic remark, only for concern, then fear, to course through the auditorium at the sight of the man's gun. Eddie and Nina bustled their charges through the exit. They hurried across the lobby and out into the Große Freiheit. The street was busier than when they had arrived.
"See any cops?"
Nina asked.
"Nope,"
Eddie replied. He gestured towards the Reaper barn.
"Police station's that way."
He started into the crowd, the others in his wake. Shouts and screams sounded from the theatre.
"They're coming!"
cried Cheng. Kramer grimaced.
I cannot go faster. My leg!"
"You can hide and we'll take the key,"
Nina suggested.
A humorless laugh.
"Do you think I'm stupid?"
"Amongst other things, yeah. Looks like your other buyers decided to save themselves 50,000 euros.
"I do not know who they are,"
Kramer protested, as he hobbled behind Eddie.
"I lie to you. There are no other..."
The Yorkshireman suddenly slowed, the sailor almost stumbling into him. Several groups of drunken young men had converged on the same stretch of street, bringing movement to a crawl.
"Buggeration and fuckery. There's 10 stag parties going on at the same time."
He searched for a quick route through the throng, found none, then simply barged into the crush. The reaction was predictably hostile. Neither he nor Nina needed fluency in German to understand the insults flung in their wake. But more angry shouts arose along the Große Freiheit behind them, rapidly getting closer. Their pursuers were catching up. Eddie went faster, shoving people aside. A youth in a football shirt screamed slurred abuse after him, his similarly attired friends joining in. Then Cheng yelled in shock as one yob knocked him to the ground.
Hey!
Nina roared into the attacker's face as she interceded, reasoning, hoping that he wouldn't hit a woman.
Back off!
She grabbed the shaken Cheng's arm and helped him up, pushing him onwards, only for him to stumble into one of several men with identical cropped haircuts.
Oi!
Barked the offended party.
Verpish dick arschlock!
Eddie heard the commotion and stopped, turning to see Nina and Cheng between the two angry groups, and coming up fast behind them, a flash of blonde hair amidst people being body-slammed out of the way. They were about to be caught in the middle of a fight. He started it early. Eddie delivered a brutal punch to one of the bellowing football fans, slamming him into his fellows, then whirled to drive an elbow into the back of someone whom he guessed from the haircut was a German sailor. The man reeled into a shipmate and knocked him down, a split second of stunned silence. Then all hell broke loose. Nina shrieked, hauling Cheng with her, as the two drunken sides launched at each other, unsure who had started the trouble and not especially caring. Eddie had already pushed on, deliberately bowling a member of a stag party into the expanding brawl as he went.
Move!
He yelled to Kramer.
Shit!
Nina yelped, as someone took a punch to the face and missed her by inches as he fell.
Damn it, Eddie!
But she knew why he had done it. The gunman and his companions were almost on them, only to be caught in the swelling chaos. The blonde man had just enough time to lock eyes with her before a drunk in a tracksuit hurled himself bodily at him. Both men fell, vanishing amongst flailing fists and feet. She saw gaps opening as the non-belligerents in the surrounding crowd tried to get clear.
Cheng, quick!
She shouted, following Eddie and Kramer. A whistle shrilled, followed by another. The police were already responding. Cheng behind her, she caught up with her husband.
Keep going,
Eddie ordered, angling towards the side of the street as the approaching cops ran down its centre.
Once we're clear of the fight, they won't even look at us.
You sure?
She asked.
Do we look like a bunch of lads out on the piss?
Good point.
They moved towards the Reaper Barn, policemen charging past with batons drawn, and reached the little plaza of the Beatlesplatz. A police car pulled up to disgorge more officers. Eddie veered well clear as the cops ran for the side street, leading the foursome past the other Fab Four.
Over the road, quick!
He led them across the Reaper Barn, ducking into the crowds outside the bars and heading for the first side street.
Down here,
he said, looking back. If their pursuers had escaped the brawl, they hadn't yet made it to the Beatlesplatz.
You know your way around here?
He asked Kramer. The German nodded.
It's a park along this road,
he said.
We can go through it to the red light district. There are always lots of people. If we can lose them.
They jogged down the side street, Kramer still hobbling.
So you don't know who they are?
Nina asked.
No,
he replied.
I lied to you about the other bias. I was trying to get more money.
But you must have spoken to someone. Otherwise, how would they have known where you were?
I spoke to no one,
Kramer insisted as they entered the park.
I only gave my address to Mr. Hui.
He glanced at Cheng.
I never saw those men before. I do not know how they found me.
They might be spooks,
Eddie suggested. Kramer didn't understand the slang.
Intelligence services, he clarified.
Spies?
Spies?
The sailor looked unnerved.
Working for who?
How would I know? The blonde guy sounded Scandinavian, but I don't know why anyone from IKEA land would want to take the key from you.
Speaking of the key,
said Nina,
have you still got it?
Kramer had kept the artifact inside his jacket.
Yes, I have decided it is too much trouble. You can have it for the 50,000 euros.
The redhead laughed and shook her head.
Can you believe this guy?
They reached the park's far side. Eddie checked the street for potential threats, seeing none.
Which way?
Kramer gestured left.
Seeing as we just saved your life,
the Yorkshireman went on as he led the way,
I think we should charge you a rescue fee. Something in the region of, oh, I don't know, 50,000 euros?
Kramer was not amused.
I was almost killed because of the key. I need money to get out of here safely. They could be waiting in my flat.
If we're talking money, that's up to Cheng.
Nina looked back at the young Chinese.
How are you doing?
He was still breathing heavily from the exertion and fear of the escape.
I'm okay. But those men tried to kill us. And you and Mr. Chase both seem so unconcerned.
Oh, I'm very concerned, trust me,
Nina replied.
But this is the kind of crap I didn't write about in my books. If I had, they'd be 600 pages long.
because it happened all the goddamn time.
Kramer directed them right. Music from bars along the New Street reached them. Nina turned back to the German.
So somebody wants the key badly enough to try to kill us. If you want to get out of here, now might be a good time to tell us more about it. Like exactly how you got hold of it and from whom?
He nodded reluctantly.
I was on a ship called Sir Fortune Mist. We heard a distress call. This was 4 months ago. From another ship, Sir Dionysus. We did not find it, but we rescued the crazy man. His name is Wim Stapper. He's Dutch. He is now in the Henkerman Hospital outside Rotterdam.
Nina made mental notes of the names.
And he had the key?
Yes. He was holding it to himself like it was the most important thing in the world.
And you stole it from him?
Yes, yes, I did,
he snapped in irritation.
And look where that has got me.
They reached a busy, noisy square.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.